Okay, good morning, everybody. It's the second talk in the BEXIS Tech Talk series named the Conceptual Model. As it's from the name, today we are going to go into detail of the conceptual model, what is inside that, and how we are going to use it in the software that we are developing. For this purpose, I will try to recall a little bit from the previous talk, which was mainly about the whole BEXIS environment, its requirements, and so on. One of the main requirements was to have a data lifecycle management so that the software that we are developing is able to manage different aspects of a data set from the beginning to the end, which we have discussed in the past talk. With the data lifecycle management, a little bit detailed, we mean to have flexible data structures, because BEXIS is going to be used in different situations by different researchers for different purposes. So there is no way to predefine even a set of data structures. So maybe we can, for example, ship the system with defined or with default data structures, but in general, the data managers or even the end user that are going to submit their data, they should be able to define their data structure. So this flexibility of data structure is one of the vital features or requirements for the data lifecycle management. And then there are different data submission scenarios, and those data submission scenarios may have, for example, different policies, different copyrights, different versioning requirements, and so on. So we should be also flexible in that way, to allow different data around the data set to manage the data set in a different life cycle. Validation is also, or in general, quality control or quality assurance is one of the features that we need, because data is coming from a variety of sources, from field surveys, from simulations, from computation, and so on, and they are not of equal quality. So there should be something in place to help to detect anomalies, to detect outliers, and so on, and hopefully in long term to help to fix them or to provide suggestions to fix them. And then preserving the data means that after submission, the data should be available, discoverable, and also reachable, like for example by DOIs or any kind of facility that provides some sort of unique data set identifier for the later use for citation and so on. And then for the purpose of data discovery, we need some sort of metadata, and this metadata is also a big part of data management in general, which we call it metadata management here. The amount of flexibility with the data structure somehow is propagated to metadata also, because different projects, different organizations have their own metadata, and they are using it for different purposes. So it's hard to force them to have one like universal metadata structure or somehow something like this. So we should also be flexible in having or to allowing different metadata and providing different ways to incorporate them in some sort of like discovery facility by preserving the variety in the metadata. Versioning in general is a very hard and also challenging problem that we are going to support. One of the main motivations that we are going to support versioning is that when you are using a data set in a publication or some people are citing it, there should be no way to change it anymore. While there is a requirement to change data, like by, for example, making quality control, quality assurance, or providing more data in time series and so on. So the data set should be kept as a live and as a live object, digital object, but the snapshot that is used in a citation, for example, should be kept as a freeze version of that data set. So this is why we are going to support versioning and also provide some facilities on versions only, like persistent identifier and so on. So with this small explanation or recall from the requirements, we are going to have a conceptual model This is an overview of the conceptual model that we are actually actively developing. Some part of it is developed now, and some parts are under active development, some parts will be extended, and so on. So it's like an active conceptual model that will have some minor changes over time, but is relatively stable now. To begin with the conceptual model, let's discuss a little bit with this components of the conceptual model. The main component that we are concerning most about it is this data package or data component that is containing all the things related to a data set. And then because the data should have a flexible data structure or flexible structure in general, we have this component of data structure that is managing all aspects of defining data structure, applying rule on data structures, and later to be used to validate the data also. As I say, data is equipped with metadata, so we have a metadata component here. And similarly to the data and data structure, metadata also has a metadata structure, which defines the structure of any of the metadata that are living in the system. So when we have this dynamism or flexibility with the metadata structure and data structure, there is two important needs. One of them is data discovery. Like, for example, if we have different metadata, how we are going to discover a data set or a different data set. This is one of the requirements that we need a semantic package or semantic component that is able to consolidate between different structures with a higher level of unified meaning. And the second requirement for this semantic package is data integration, like when we are going to integrate multiple data sets that are somehow partially sharing different data structures or have some common variables, for example. In that case, this semantic component is going to help us to automatically or semi-automatically find out which parts of data set or in general which data set are good candidates to be integrated together. And then with the data, we have some contextual information like institutes, universities, projects, I don't know, sites, and so on. And this all surrounding information that defines the ownership of data, the contributors to the data, and so on, are captured in the administration package. And also the policies that apply to the data, like publishing policies, sharing policies, and so on. They are all managed by the administration component. As any information system, we have the security component, which has a normal AAA requirement or responsibilities, authentication, authorization, and auditing. And then BEXIS in general is actually a research data management. And we are active in field of ecology, although not restricted to ecology or biodiversity and so on, which has an implication that most of the data is somehow geo-related. So that, for example, a field survey has happened in a specific site, or a specific observation are made in a specific locations, like a tree or a soil sample is captured somewhere, and so on. So there is a different level of relationship between the data sets and the geographical extents or geographical information. So we are capturing also this kind of geographical information in the geo components here to be able to have, for example, geographical search or multiple layering on top of each other to have some sort of visual integration and so on. That's the general concept that we are going to have in BEXIS system and is mostly done for data, data structure, metadata, and metadata structure. A lot on security, like 30% on administration, and some smaller number on geo and semantic components.
Is that allowed to interrupt you?
I will tell you in a minute that when to interrupt me. So from now on, we will go to any of these components and describe them in more detail. But before that, all these packages are just shrink to one conceptual model here, so that the BEXIS system would have a conceptual model in general, and then anything else would be managed in terms of modules. So that, for example, if there is a smaller or adjacent conceptual model for land use or for publishing or for search or for data submission or anything else, it would be developed as a standalone module. We have some rules to define how the modules conceptually interact with the core conceptual model and so on. So the conceptual model is not going to solve everything, but we are going to stay with the data lifecycle management functions and requirements. Anything else would be defined and developed as a module or as a set of modules. So from now on, I will go through each component. At the end of each component, I will stop for the questions and maybe small breaks, and then we will go on through the presentation. So from now on, we would have 8 components to discuss, and then maybe 8 or even more times to interrupt. So if there is any question up to now, we have a short stop here.
Yeah, I would have a question. It's you spoke about dataset also in between, and my question is if you have inside this overview or overall a definition of a dataset, because you have data there and data structure, metadata, but is there any virtual class or whatever?
Yeah, we will see them in the data component. We will go in detail. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Okay.
There is a small definition and also a specification in terms of this UML class diagrams.
Okay.
To see what we mean by a data set.
Okay. Good. Okay, my question about the geo component, why it is related to administration package and what, for example, data structure things?
Actually, data structure is not talking about any place or anything. It's just talking about the variables that a data set can have. And that variables can be anything that when I discuss them, they have a lot of different things. That one of them is unit of measurement, for example, or data type. And data type can be a geo feature. So if you are going to capture like a variable that shows the location, that location will be captured by a data structure item that we will select there.
But there is some hidden relation between the geo component and the data structure?
Yeah. So if you see here, this is just the usage. So which component is using which other component? It's not exactly how they are interdependent. It's just an overview that how they are interacting with each other. And we will see why geo is somehow unisolated and not using anything else. We will see in the latest package, I guess. Okay. So let's go to the data component. The main concept or class interchangeably in the data component is the concept of data set, which in general is a container for almost anything, but we mean observations, for example, measurements, simulations, and other supported form of data, but it can be any data which like a file or a collection of file or anything. Our focus in data set in the conceptual model is basically a tabular data set which means a set of tuples, and each tuple is a set of data cells, and those cells are data containers. So it's like that, for example, if you're observing a phenomenon, that phenomenon can be attributed by some sort of variables, and each of those variables are one of the columns of this data set, and any single observation of those columns is a tuple here. So this is a general concept of data set that we will use, but over time it will be refined to some restrictions and some more specification. As we will see later, data set has a data structure to define its structure. That's the thing that we want a data set to be. But as one of requirements say, that the data set will grow over time or change over time, but a snapshot of data set and at a specific time are required for citation or for reproduction and so on. So we have data set version concept also, which means that a data set can have multiple versions. Any citation or reproduction requirement happens on the versions, and the version are straightforward check-in, check-out, edit, and check-in process, which means blocking checkout. So it's not possible to check out a data set version twice or more. It's just a single checkout, lock, edit, and check it in. And there is another requirement also, or restriction, let's say in this case, that check-in should be done by the checkout user. So it's not possible, for example, or not designed in that way, that I check out the data set and you can later check it in. It's just my responsibility to edit, approve it, and check it in. And also we don't support forking, like multiple branches of versions and later merging. It's very hard, and we simply just ignore this kind of complexity. So it's a linear versioning and also blocking versioning. So this say then tuples are some of collections of data items regarding to one observation or one simulation result or whatever attached to the dataset versions. Any edit, deletion, and addition happens on the tuples belonging to a version, and then all the operations are preserved so that it's possible to reproduce a version that is changed by the later versions. Although that when you are asking for a data set, by default the latest version of data set is provided. And just for information is that we keep differential versioning. It's not like duplicating any version. We just compute the version based on the operation, compute the differences based on the operation that is done between a checkout and the check-in, and then keep that difference somehow in the system to make it reproducible later when that version is requested. Okay, as tuples are belonging to the versions, then data cells are belonging to the tuples. So it means that any tuple is a collection of cells, that any cell actually is a single or multiple value by design. So cells can have just a single value or multiple value, but they are not just values. They keep some sort of small metadata about the value that they contain, like description of that cell, the sampling time if it was a sampling, the result time if there was a lag between the result, like sampling, processing, and result. If there is a lag between these things, this time, two different times are captured, and there are also some many minor auxiliary information on the cell. So the cell itself, although is designed to keep a value, but is like a compound data item also that can be used for further processing by, for example, analysis tools or visualization tools and so on. So when we keep versions as main data containers, it means that metadata is also associated with the version, not with the data set, so that it's possible from version to have different metadata or to change metadata as part of the checkout, edit, check-in process also. But again, by default, when a dataset is asked for the metadata in general, the latest version's metadata is assumed to be the metadata of the whole dataset. But when a specific version is asked, the specific metadata of that version is provided. For example, if you are searching for a dataset, in the search, the latest version's metadata is actually the active metadata, but the others are also preserved. As there is a data life, usually there is a data life cycle in place, the dataset or dataset version can go under some sort of workflows, like for example, reviewing and then peer reviewing and then validation and so on and so on. So there is a staging system also in place that dataset versions can be tagged by a specific stage and a lot of other information like the time, who has done that stage or who has put the version in that stage and description that what that stage means or any comment and so on. So that this information also is able to be used as quality indicators or as progress indicators and so on. The stage of the latest version of a dataset is also assumed to be dataset stage. For example, if a dataset has a version that is published, the whole dataset is assumed to be published up to the time that you change that dataset version, for example, to a new dataset version and mark it as raw data again, or not validated, or failed to validate, and so on. Okay, that was the basic concept of a dataset. So just to recall, it was a dataset with some versions, some tuples, and some data source attached to the tuple. But for a specific cases, we have some extensions. These extensions are somehow not in the main flow of dataset production, but in some cases they are required to have like occasional data on this, on some of the tuples and so on. So one of these extensions is called amendments. Actually, amendment is a special kind of data cell, is again a data cell, but can be attached to a tuple of interest, not all the tuples. And also you can attach different amendments to different tuples of interest. So it's like an occasional data, exceptional data, or something like this that you want on a specific tuple. One of the use cases for this is that, for example, you are measuring a soil sample, for example, and then you observe a different color than a normal accepted color. In that case, you want to capture that exceptional color of the soil as an amendment, but is not designed to be part of the general data set. This is a facility that can help in this kind of scenarios. Another sort of or another type of extension is that you can have extended properties on a data set so that, for example, all the data sets are following a specific data structure that you have designed, but you want some specific property on one of the data sets. Like, for example, you want to have define the error margin on the temperature, on the body temperature on a bird, for example, or to have the depth of a sampling in the soil, like minus 10, minus 12, or something. If this information are not captured in the data structure, you can just simply put them on your own data set and then use them for any further processing. We will see some example of these things in, I guess, two or three slides, if it's not really obvious from the conceptual model. And then in some cases, you don't need to have the whole data structure for any reason, you can put restriction on the number of tuples visible and also number of columns visible. So it's a subsetting of data set by selection or by projection. You can do it, for example, by further processing if there is an analysis that is interested in just the temperature and location, and also the temperatures that are just positive. In that case, you can truncate or shrink the data set to a specific view on that data set and then do the processing. Another use case would be sharing. If you're going to share a subset of your data set with someone for any reason, or putting security rules on some sort of your data set to protect it, for example, against public access, or for digital rights, sometimes you don't have proper right to publish a subset of your data set or subset of data set that you're working on. In this kind of scenarios, it's good to have a view. And then that view is actually like a virtual data set with a smaller amount of data inside. We have two sort of views. One view that is just applying on one data set, and another view that we call it the spanning view, that is across multiple data sets that are using same structure. So if you have multiple time series, for example, that share the same structure, you can put a spanning view on top of all of them and then create a subset of them for your purpose. This is the example that I was just mentioning earlier. This is a standard data set as our conceptual model. So for example, here is the structure of the data that currently they are two variables. Actually, we have a definition for variable that we later see. For now, just assume that it's a variable, it's another variable. This row is called a tuple, and any single cell here is a data cell with that compound attributes inside. Here we are just showing the value, not, for example, the sampling time or result time or anything else. And then extensions here are, for example, this is the amendment. With this amendment, we have two data values for this tuple, nothing here, another one here, nothing here, and three different things also here. So they don't need, even if they are in the same column, they don't need to be of similar variable or any correlation between them. And also the number of amendments per tuple is just something that the data designer or data owner decides. And then with extended properties, you can extend this header item for this data set only by an extended property that is, for example, here called interval for time, that is 1 second, and then rounded with values yes for the temperature, because, for example, temperature is normally a float or a floating point number, but here is just rounded for any purpose. And then soil nitrogen has an error margin of 10% minus plus. So this is an extra data that is not captured here by the general structure. And with the views, is that, for example, here view has a projection over temperature, time, and humidity, but no selection here. All the data is available, I guess. 22, 23, 21, 18, 14, yeah. All the data is here, but here you see is a projection and also a selection here. So it was able to filter the rows and also filter the column. And there is also a globalization information that if, for example, you are working in a multi-language team, you can put tags in different languages on single variables. Like, for example, SM here means soil moisture, but is also provided in other languages. Some sort of a small facility for multicultural teams or for big audiences. So to close this package or this component is just the data component all together. Here we will see the data set that has some data set versions. Each version has a stage. dataset have their own tuples, and this aggregation or composition means that tuples are only belonging to one dataset version. It's not possible to share them. And also tuples have their own data souls and their amendments. The rest here, this boxed ones, are something, actually the linkage between the packages. For example, this metadata is the linkage between the data package and metadata package that we will see later. This two here are the linkage between the data package and metadata package, data structure package here, so that we will see in each package that which concepts are somehow linked together, so that the overall conceptual model is not some sort of islands. They are a sort of integrated model that we have just packed them to some smaller packages to be manageable. So this is the first stop point, I guess. If there is any question, that would be good. Just check it. Yeah. Just simple questions, please.
Yeah, actually for amendment.
Mm-hmm.
I see it is, I don't know if it has a name or without, since it doesn't belong to a specific variable. So how can be reachable or discoverable?
It's not visible from this model because it's part of the data structure. Let's see it. Amendment here. Actually, amendment is a data cell when we see the whole picture. Is a data cell, and data cell is connected to the variable. It's just maybe two slides later, after this stop, in the data structure, we will see that amendment is a specific data cell, and data cell is a data container that is attached to its definition. So
this means there is a variable defined before to catch or to keep the value of such amount, how we can. And now when we design the data structure, I don't know at that moment if I need such amount or not. So how I define or.
So you are talking about the behavior of the system, that how is possible to create an amendment. It's something that we don't talk about it right now. We are just talking about the structure or the actually data items that are required to provide that function. So that when and how these features are available or accessible to the system is something out of scope.
Okay, but it should have name.
Like what?
Variable name to
be. Yeah, it's attached. You will see it, okay, yeah. That how they are connected to each other, but how the system provides this feature,
okay, yeah,
we don't know.
Yeah.
In the picture you show, there is no variable attached to the amendment, but it means there should be a variable name.
Yeah, it's
to
just
each,
for the simplicity of the presentation.
Yeah, there should be a variable name there. Okay.
No more. I have also one question, and it's to this metadata. You said that this metadata is attached to dataset version.
Yeah.
That means if I, for instance, change something inside metadata, it will create a new dataset version.
Exactly.
And I don't know if this is part of the conceptual model or later in the behavior in the system, that there will be some restrictions on metadata added.
The restriction itself can be part of the metadata, that currently I don't remember if we have any restriction, but how that is applied is part of the behavior of the system.
Okay.
So I don't really remember now that whether we have a restriction on the amount or how to change the metadata, but we will see something in the metadata package. Hopefully you get your answer there.
Yeah.
I mean, one issue is with this extended properties. I think what you capture there can normally also simply
kept in the data structured means a scientist can also simply from beginning provide a data structure which captures all the variables which are inside this extended properties, or design a second data set with that maybe extended properties inside and connected to the other. It's just an option you provide. So it's not necessarily to use it. It's on the.
It's an extension.
It's an extension, and it's on the way how the scientists want to use it or not.
Okay. There is a small difference is that when you try to capture something with this extension, extended properties, it applies only on that single data set.
Yep.
But if you capture something at the data structure level, it may also apply to other data sets that are sharing that structure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it depends whether you want it for this single data set or for all the data sets that are belonging to the data structure.
Okay. So this is really just to the data set. It's,
exactly.
It's like
this is like a personalized
data structure to the data set.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then let's move to the data structure. That was like most of the questions are there. So from now on, just remember that we had a data set that needed a structure, and now we are going to define or to know what is this structure and how is defined or specified. So as usual, when we are talking about data structure, the cornerstone is the data structure itself. It's actually the organization and meaning of the data. With the meaning of data means that we will define some attributes or some variables that with the help of those attributes or variables, we know what a data column means. And also with organization, maybe, for example, the ordering of those data and some sort of this kind of information, or, for example, accessibility to those data is also captured with the data structure. The data structure itself has two subtypes, unstructured data and structured data. With structured data, actually, we are looking to specify how a tabular data set should be defined, and anything else is considered unstructured data. With unstructured data, we don't mean that the data has no structure. We actually mean that we are not interested in the structure of that data. So, for example, a file-based LiDAR data or a NetCDF file have their own structure, but for any reason, we are not interested in their internal structure, so we just categorize them as unstructured. So maybe later when we are able, I mean the system functions are able to extract their structure, maybe they just move from unstructured to a structured data. So it's just a relative concept based on the functionalities, or actually the complexity of the functionality of the system. So then from now on, we are just basically talking about how a structured data structure is organized and what is inside that. If you remember with the tabular data, we have some header items or column names, for example. Those column names from now on are called variables here. But as you see, variable is an association between data structure and data attribute. Actually, data attribute is just an abstract definition, like, for example, a temperature, which has a unit of measurement, which has some restriction, for example, which has some constraint on the data type that is holding there, and so on. But when you are going to use this data attribute in a data set or a set of data set, then we just label it as a variable, and this label has some additional data. Actually, the reason why we are labeling it is that, for example, in one data structure or one data set, you want to call this temperature as T or temperature or temp or anything else. So this kind of customized labeling are captured by the variables. And also in some cases, you want to say this temperature, where is my mouse? This temperature in this data set is optional, but in another data set is not optional. So this kind of data structure specific or data set specific values are held in the variable, but the abstract definition without the usage would be captured in the data attribute. For example, here we have the data set again. Here are the tuples. Here are the headers, and each of these items is supposed to be a variable. With this kind, we just extract the variables, like here recording time, air temperature, soil temperature, and humidity, and the rest of the data set is just a tuple. So there is no header anymore inside the data set. They are just extracted out to have this variable. And then we bind all these variables to each other and name them, like in this case, soil sampling, and this is called a data structure. So data structure is basically a set of variables. But where the definition of this variable is coming from is from the data attributes. For example, here we know that air temperature and soil temperature both are talking about temperature, so it's possible to factor the shared part of their concept into a temperature concept and then just have it once but use it twice or even more. So this is some sort of encouraging reusability, and also later we use it for data integration. So for example, if there are two data sets that one has air temperature and one has soil temperature, they are attached or linked to temperature, we know some similarity, and then we can use that similarity to suggest or to automatically merge them. And then the rest of information that is required to define this temperature is just attached to the temperature data attribute, not to the variables. Like for example, here unit is going to be Celsius and the data type is going to be a floating number. So we know that, for example, here this is a valid data because it's a floating number. And also from this, we know that is a soil temperature that is a temperature that its unit is Celsius. So we know a lot about this single value of data here without having any duplication. And then the others also, like here, for example, timestamp is a serial. So it's just a series of items. There is a typo here, sorry. Its data type is a number, for example. Or here, with the humidity, we know that there's a ratio that doesn't need a type, doesn't need a unit, but is sharing the data type with the temperature because both of them are float, although the data is not float here. So this kind of sharing here and sharing here help us to reduce the amount of unit, amount of data types, and also amount of data attributes. And because of these links, we can use it for integration, as I said, and also cross data set querying. Like for example, if you are looking for any data set that contains temperature over 20, then we can use this temperature, go to all those variables that are linked to this temperature in any data set, and also go to another set of data sets that are using the same one, and then compare them and find out, okay, there is a temperature in this data set, there is another temperature in that data set. And one step further is that with the units, we have a unit conversion system also that is able to help us to, for example, convert from one unit to another unit and also provide some sort of higher level search and integration so that, for example, we know 10 degrees Celsius should be 50 degrees Fahrenheit, for example. So it's possible to compare these things as also return something meaningful to the user when searching for temperature around 10. So with that said, then a data set is linked to a data structure, which means that all the versions of that data set should have shared their single data structure. So it's not possible to change the data set version structure from a version to another. It's just you can change metadata and also the data values. So with the data container that we were talking about, with the data attribute, actually data attribute is a subtype of a data container in general that we also use it later for metadata, but now we are just focusing on the data attribute here, is actually just factoring out all the shared and abstract attributes of variables to encourage reusability, like, as I said, unit of measurement, data type, data validation rules, and so on. So it's possible to reuse the data containers in different structures and label them as different variables. So from now on, think of a variable just as a label to a data attribute, maybe with some extra or more specific constraints. So this kind of sharing helps us with automatic unit conversion, cross-data subquery, as I say, easier data integration, and also enhanced data discovery. When you know all this information, it's possible to use them in data discovery and also specifically cross-data set or collection of data sets that are somehow related together but don't share a single data structure. So to place the data container into a context, just this is the previous slide in the smaller version. Now we will see what else is linked to a data container. Here, as I said, unit of measurement and data type. And then we have the methodology that this data container or this data attribute was used, for example, to measure the data. So if you are doing an automatic measuring, or you have a logger in place somewhere, or you are doing laboratory work and so on, maybe you need to measure the methodology. Aggregate functions are actually those functions that you can apply later, or an analysis tool can apply on a data attribute to compute, for example, the summation, maximum, minimum, standard deviation, and so on. So based on the data type here and unit of measurement and some additional attributes, the designer of this data container can decide which aggregate functions are applicable on this data attribute so that later automatic analysis tool can apply them and provide some sort of overview on this data for the data users. And then there are some constraints that you can apply on any data container, like validators, default value, and also missing values and domain values, which means if data attribute can accept a specific list of items, for example. In that case, you can define them as domain values. If it accepts a range of anything, you can define it here as a validator. If it should have a pattern, for example, you can define it also here. So there are some subtypes also here that are just omitted to simplify the presentation. But as far as I remember, there are four different subtypes here that you can define as constraints. And as you can see from this association here, you can apply as much as constraint as you like on a data container. And also there is no ordering here. So if one of them fails, the data set or data attribute is reported to fail on a specific data set. If all of them are satisfied, then data is considered to be valid. So there is no priority in constraint checking. And then, as you remember, I guess, this extended property and globalization information are also here. So you can globalize any data attribute, you can globalize any metadata attribute, and so on. And the measurement scale is something reserved for the data attributes. I'm not going to detail here. And finally, there is a semantic description that actually links the data container to the semantic package that we will discuss later. So it's possible to semantically annotate any data container, which means any data attribute and also any metadata attribute and more. We will see more later. So anything here with the data container? Nothing here. And then just to make a little bit more obvious how they are linked together, just take a look at this data cell here. Each tuple has a set of owned data cells, and then each data cell is linked to a variable, that is a label, but this variable knows which data attribute is actually the definition, so that from the data cell I can navigate to the variable and from there navigate to its associated data attribute and then find out, okay, this is an attribute that's talking about temperature, is unit is X, is annotated this way, and so on and so on. So most of, let's say, metadata about a data cell is captured by this data attribute and its associated variable, like here. And then, as you see here, amendment is a subtype of data cell, which means it's also linked to a variable, which again is linked to a data attribute. So just think of amendment as a data cell, but it's differentiated for actually distinguished system behavior. So from conceptually perspective, there is no difference. But when we mark the mark amendment as a specific class later at the system behavior layer, we can have a specific functions that operate on amendments. And then again, data structure package all together here. The central point is the data container with all its surroundings, like constraints, data types, and units. With the unit, you see the conversion method that are also able to convert from one unit to another. And then here you see the structure, that is structured data, to the variables, and then to the attributes and so on. So it's like, again, a bigger picture of the data structure in general and how it's associated to a data set. Something that I didn't talk about in the previous slide is that data attributes have their classifier, or they are able to be classified somehow. So this classification is open classification. There are, at the system layer, there are some automatic classification, like by data type, by unit of measurements, by aggregate function applicable, and so on. But it's a free classification here also, which is hierarchical classification, that can be good for data structure design, for example, and so on. So the second stop point, and any question is welcome.
Can you please go back one slide?
Yes.
And you spoke about amendments, and that's with the association or the linkage from variable to this data attribute and structured data, you will have this variable to an amendment. And but a variable is an association between an attribute and a structured data. That means if I have amendment, I need also a data structure for this amendment.
Yeah, that's right. Actually, we are going to relax this to have no requirement to have a data structure.
Yeah.
But the problem is that when you have a data set,
yeah,
actually it means that you currently have a data structure. There is
yes.
no way to
what,
to skip it.
Yeah.
But the challenge is that if this amendment is going to amend some information to a tuple in a specific data set,
yeah,
then that variable shouldn't be visible to other data sets.
Yeah.
There is something that we are thinking how to handle it, but currently it's just as simple as you see.
Okay.
Should be limited to that data set.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Other.
Yeah. Currently, it's not like that. It should be like the extended properties that are just for that single data set, but currently it's
no.
more than that.
No. Because you spoke also that I remember correctly, the structure of the amendments can be differ between each tuple. I can have if I want, I can have different information as an amendment to a tuple.
That's right, yeah.
So that means then I would need a data structure for every amendment that can overload maybe
the process of it creating. Makes the data structure highly complicated.
Yeah. Yeah, that's just what I was asking.
I think data type can be go to under the constraint, since the data type itself is a constraint.
Yeah, with constraint, actually, we mean something that is used in the data validation, which in the data lifecycle management happens later. But with the data type is something that happens at the exact submission type. So it's not possible to have no data type as a submission type. But it's possible to have no constraint or don't apply the constraint at the submission time. So this is why we just made a differentiation between data type and also, I guess, some other small thing with the constraint.
But data type itself can be considered as a constraint.
Exactly, yeah. But we just made this differentiation because we know the system behavior.
Yeah. So you mean the constraint here is or has another
another purpose. Exactly, yeah. And you see the association here says that is is star to a star, which means it's optional. So you can have a data container that has no constraint at all, or you can attach constraints later, or you can have constraints but apply them later.
Okay. I have the data semantic, the semantic description here. You mean only to go to the structure of your data set, but you can also add some annotation or semantic description to the tuple itself.
Yeah, they will come later. At this part, we are talking about the data structure only, and we say in the data structure, the data container is associated to semantic description. But later we will see some more also.
Yeah, but actually in both in the general conceptual model, both semantic component actually is connected to both the data structure and the metadata structure.
Yeah.
There is no direct link.
That's right. That's right.
Data.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Yeah, that's a good point. So it's captured here. We won't forget to correct it. Okay, anything else?
Thank you.
Okay, let's then go to the metadata. So we have data and this structure somehow defined. Actually, you mean something like this from here to here. Yeah, that's right. Thank you. And now we are going to describe how metadata is organized. Let's see. So, as we have seen before, metadata is associated with the dataset version. From this composition, you see that metadata cannot be shared between versions or versions of different dataset, is belonging to a specific dataset, and also is one-to-one relationship. So is any dataset must have one metadata, even empty, and also any metadata belongs to only one dataset version. The role of metadata is that to capture all the data required about the data set. And this requirement comes from different perspectives. And this is why metadata are so diverse. We will see the diversity in a few minutes. So when we say that there is a one-to-one relationship between metadata and data set version, means that the versioning process applies on the metadata too. So it's possible to check out the dataset version, apply some changes on the data or metadata, and then check it in. And as Andreas just mentioned earlier, even changing on metadata only creates new versions. If the reason is that we have to keep that snapshot of dataset version for like in under any circumstances, so that when you make a version, that's it, finalized. Any change, even to metadata later, is captured as a new version. With the metadata insight, then, metadata actually is consists of some metadata attribute values, and I guess you remember metadata attribute from the previous slide. Don't take this simple now, because we have some other types also. So it's metadata attribute, and we have some values in the metadata. In general, we can say that there is a dataset version that has a metadata, and metadata contains some values, and those values have some meanings or some definitions. That's a simple, a straightforward definition of the structure of metadata. This metadata attribute values are very similar to data cells, and this metadata attributes are very similar to data attributes. So there is an analogy between metadata and data in terms of definition. And then, with the metadata, we say that there are some metadata attributes associated with the data inside the metadata. Because of the variety of metadata, also we need a metadata structure that defines which metadata should or must contain which attributes inside. So it's like that when I define a metadata structure, I say, okay, any data set that is using this metadata structure should have this kind of information as its metadata. We will see more about this metadata structure later in the metadata structure package, but for now, just think is something similar to the data structure that defines what should go inside the metadata. And to see how it's associated, we have a data set that has some versions. Each version has a metadata, and then the metadata has its structure. From this structure, later we know that what are the metadata attributes, and then the values are belonging to a metadata with this cardinality, but they know their own definitions also. So it's possible, for example, to know from the metadata that this single item is an address, for example, and this address is defined as an attribute somewhere, or is a telephone number, or is a geographical extent of the location that this dataset was, for example, observed there, and so on. That was too short. Good. So just short to stop again, if there is any question with the metadata. We will see some examples later again, but how metadata is structured, I guess. Yeah, in the metadata structure, there are some examples. So for now, just think that metadata is a collection of values that each value knows its definition. And the whole metadata as a single data item or a single complex data item is associated to a dataset version to describe that version. Good, then we just go on. So now we go to the metadata structure to see how metadata structure is defined and how it affects the metadata actually. So the main purpose for a metadata structure is to determine what should or must be captured by the metadata. So it's like the organization of the metadata. And as I said at the beginning of the requirements, that different data sets may have different metadata. And for that, we have to have different metadata structures or the ability to define different metadata structures. But The metadata structure itself is actually a hierarchical structure, so that you can create a top metadata structure and also some children on that, and then any children can act as a metadata structure again. So if you don't need the whole metadata structure, you can just use a subset of it or a subtree of it, let's say. And then at each subtree or as at any level of that tree of the metadata structure, you can organize the metadata in terms of packages. Like, for example, a person with name, affiliation, degree, contact, and so on can be one package, so that you can just use it. And the packages are actually composed of some attributes, which attributes are the single data item containers. So that, for example, in the person case, again, is that name is an attribute, last name is another attribute, affiliation is another attribute, and then you can put them together and name them a person package, so that using this person package or reusing it would be also easier. The metadata attributes it's like that you can share them also with this association here. So that, for example, if name is used in a person package, it can be also used in another package. So there is a sharing and reusability here, and also a sharing and reusability here. So if you have defined a good package, you can use it in multiple structures. Like, for example, the geographical extent can be used in multiple data structures. Contacts can be used in different metadata structures. Data set definition or data set description itself can be a good candidate for a package that is used among different structures and so on. But the data set, metadata attribute itself also has two subtypes. One is the metadata simple type, that is a real definition of the data container, so that metadata attributes are attached to this one. But in some cases, we can have a compound of, if you see this link here, a compound of two or more simple and compound attributes as another compound. So, for example, geolocation can be a compound attribute because it has longitude, latitude, and in some cases altitude also. So you can define them as three different simple attributes if you like, but also you can put them together as a single compound attribute that are always used together. With compound attributes, actually we mean that they are always used together, not sometimes. So it's like conceptually they are one thing, but for actually data holding purposes, we need the sub items also. Like, another component can be a date, that you can say year, month, day, and also the time. They are components or the parts of the date time. Maybe you need them, for example, for querying based on year, based on month. Maybe you need them for aggregation, and so on and so on. But generally, they are always coming together. So in that case, a compound type named date would be here. But also a single attribute named year or month or day can also come here. But at the end, it's the simple types that are associated to the attribute values, because value is a single value and must be connected to an attribute, and then the rest is based on the attribute. So from the attribute you know is part of this compound, okay, then you can do something more with the compound. To put them together is that we have a metadata that has a structure, a hierarchical structure. So it's actually a node in the metadata structure tree. And then that node is associated with some packages. Package or any of the packages can have some metadata attributes. and metadata attributes are simple or compound with this recursive link here that make compound of compound also possible. And then the values from one side belong to a metadata, from one side are linked to a data attribute to know their own definition. Okay, then here metadata packages or any single metadata package can be used in different metadata structures, which means that there is a possibility that one structure can use a package under a specific requirements or under a specific constraint. This constraint is captured here with the metadata package usage. So for example, you want this package A to be used in your metadata structure, but you want to label it as B. Or you want it to be repeated like at least 3 times. Or you want to put a maximum number of repetition on this package. So this kind of information that is actually applying to the link between a package and data structure are captured by the usage. So for example, here I can say that person package can be used in this metadata structure, but it should be named authors because I am describing the authors of a data set. So I label it as authors, and then authors has a minimum cardinality of 1. So at least 1 author should be present for any data set, and then is unbounded. So 10, 20, 100 authors can also be modeled with this usage. The same thing happens here with the attributes among the packages. So you can use an attribute under different name in different packages and also put different cardinalities. A specific cardinality of 0 to 1, I mean minimum 0, maximum 1 means optional. 1 to 1 means mandatory. And anything else has its own meaning, like 1 to 10 means minimum 1, maximum 10. And this kind of cardinality can be used for later UI generation, for validation, for suggesting data entry, and so on. So for example here, a data attribute can be a date, for example, and then it's used in one package as project start date, but it can be used in another package as publication date. And this project start date and publication date actually are labeled here that define the usage between an attribute with 2 different metadata packages. It's also possible to use one metadata attribute more than once in one package. For example, here, if this package needs project start date and project end date, in that case, both of them are linking to a single metadata attribute that is called date. So there would be 2 associations and 2 usages. At the end, it's also possible with this link, because compounds can have 2 or more simple attributes or compound attributes, so it's possible also to label a simple attribute in a compound attribute or another compound attribute in a bigger compound attribute. So for example, here a person can be a compound attribute that has an address. That address is again a compound attribute. So, but you can label it as home address or work address or something else address. So it's possible to play with this kind of labeling and cardinalities to use one item more than once in a bigger item. Okay, at the end, I guess here is that when you have your metadata structure defined in this way, normally you need some sort of mapping information for exporting your metadata structure to the outside world. So that, for example, if you are going to export your metadata to EML, there should be some mapping information between attributes of your metadata structure to EML attributes or EML packages, modules, and so on. This mapping information actually helps for the export of metadata, for example, for publishing to public repositories, public catalogs, and so on, and also for importing metadata from other systems to BEXIS. So this is the purpose of mapping information here. And then when we put all these things together, is that we have a metadata structure here that has some metadata packages. The package is a container also, so you have some definition for that. And metadata attributes are also data containers, so you can put as much as information as you like on the data attribute. And then the subtypes here, the usages here, three type of usages, and the normal dataset version metadata structure with the associated metadata and also with the metadata attribute values of that specific metadata. That's the general overview of the metadata structure. I guess it's also a stop point here. No? Yeah. And then, just to make an example of this metadata structure, metadata package, and metadata attribute, just see the analogy here to an EML element. So here, for example, this is the module data set that we call it a package. And then inside this package or module, there are some elements. Some of them are referred to other elements. Like, for example, we are referring from one package to another package or to another compound. And some of them are just defined here like this one. So it's a simple attribute of a specific type. This is referring to a compound package, for example. This is another reference to another compound. This coverage, for example, can be, or I guess it's like a geographical extent or something like this. And then you see the cardinality is also here. So here is minimum, zero, maximum, unbound, but it could be any other valid number here. So this kind of analogies are captured with that metadata structure. And the mapping info actually captures the path to this element and associates them to our own metadata attributes so that we can regenerate this EML structure on export, for example, or to ingest this EML structure when we need to import a metadata to BEXIS system. Yeah, and then it's again a stop point, but I stop here if you're going to refer to something. Question?
I have a question. Do not fully understand the difference between metadata attribute and metadata package.
Mm-hmm.
As I understood, in metadata attribute, you can combine different compounds.
Mm-hmm.
And would that not be a possibility to form this kind of packages as you described? Or
There is a little bit of difference between them. Packaging here means any sort of packaging that you as a data manager think is good for your purpose.
Okay.
Like, for example, you can define a geographical extent or a data set part, like the EML, for example, here is a data set. In this case, you can put something or some information that are not really related to each other by their nature, but you need them for the purpose of your metadata description. But with the compounds, we mean something that is naturally together. Like, for example, when you are talking about the address, is a street, a house number, postcode, and this kind of things are normally together. So you don't need to put them together for your purpose. So this is only the like conceptual difference between them. I guess in the implementation part we have some different restrictions on them. But generally, yeah, that was the purpose why we have compound and also package. And also, if you look at the EML, for example, they call this big one a module, so you can optionally add different modules. But these things like reference to another thing, like alternate identifier or creator and something, actually this creator is a label for a person compound that they also using it, but I don't know how they call it. So these kind of things are some sort of noun in structuring data. The thing that we don't have as a restriction, for example, is that here the data set is a module and also project is a module. So in EML, it's possible to reference from inside the module to another module. But in our case, it's not possible to have a package inside the package. I guess we just omitted it to make it simpler because it's already too complex. But with the compound, it's possible because it was out of our control. When you say compound, means that it's naturally inside. So,
I agree with you. And then since this naming the scheme misunderstood, for example, metadata package and metadata. But I can say, for example, you can rename it as type, and this type contains instead of also attribute. Attribute by itself it is simple, but it can be, for example, an element, metadata element, and then that element could be simple element or complex element, and then or compound element. It's similar to the XML data. Since XML data,
it's a matter of naming. We started with this concept of attribute, and then it was just there. But
for data structure, it's okay since you are talking about tabular data, and it's okay with the tabular scheme, you have attributes, and it's okay. But for metadata structure, you are talking with a hierarchical structure. And actually, with this hierarchical structure, the naming attribute is misleading.
Okay.
So you can rename it as element, and here it's okay. Why? Since you talk here about hierarchical structure. And in the hierarchical structure, the element is okay, and then from that element you have simple element, and also compound element. And the element could contain attribute. For example, if you go to your example, you have some element here. You have element here, okay? Inside such element, you can have another attribute or associated attribute. Actually, in your conceptual model, you don't mention such cases. You have only simple attribute, this is here element, but what's the case if that attribute has some other feature?
Like what feature?
Like for example, this is the element. Okay, the name of the element, the data type, the maximum minimum occurrence, actually all these are properties or features of that element. So it's better is to rename it as element. From that element you have simple element and compound element. Each element,
there are two things here. First is just a naming convention that we use, and second part is that this EML is an implementation of that concept. You know, the difference here is that when we are going to implement this concept, maybe we just implement it exactly as EML or something else. So there should be a difference between how the concept is communicated and how implementation is going on. Like for example here, no attribute by its internal...
For example, yes, if the element data set, and this data set has ID version, so the element here is the data set, but the version of the data set is attribute of that element.
Yeah, but version is not an attribute of itself. Version is an attribute of the dataset version that you're attaching to it. As an attribute, you don't know what is the version. You are just an attribute.
But you can
like
put,
a definition.
But you can put such kind of attribute or feature inside the metadata itself. So for example, the element dataset, you can associate other attributes to that element, like feature, like date, and so on.
So they are. When you say that data attribute is a data container, means that they are all connected to it. Like with the data attribute, metadata attribute, or as you said, metadata element, you know that you can have units, you can have data types, you can have attributes,
yeah,
and anything.
I took only from the naming misunderstanding. This, the attribute itself is a symbol thing. Attribute means a symbol.
Yeah, that's, as I said, with the naming, we can just think about it or change it. It's very simple. But the main concept is that we have different type of metadata containers. The simplest one is that simple attribute that you call it element or simple element.
Yes.
The compound one or compound element is something that is aggregation
is
of those
set
things
of
and
elements,
so on.
Yes.
Yeah.
A set of elements.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. And in that case, the metadata package could, for example, you can name it as a type, and the type can be element or some other thing.
EML, for example, names it as a module.
Well, yes, you can.
We discussed these things and then just chose this one, maybe for no reason, or I don't know what was the reason, because it's like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
But this kind of discussion is just, we can just take it, but maybe next time someone else can say, okay, why element, why not something else? So I will capture this notes and put them in parentheses or in replacement.
You can,
but it doesn't change the concept.
You can rename it as you like, but actually the word attribute itself means simple thing, especially for the hierarchical structure.
Okay.
So it preserves it for simple things. So you can rename it as you like, but the word attribute itself for the structure, for the scheme, hierarchical structure, is preserved for simple stuff.
Okay, so we will change it. It doesn't matter. Anything else? Okay, then let's go to the administration package. As I said, administration package is going to handle the contextual data, like institutes, projects, and so on, plus the policies. So this package would have two sections. The first section is about the people and organization, and the second one is about the policies. The first one is called party package because it's almost about the people, organizations, project, and so on, and we made this generalization name on the party to name both organizations and people into like a more general term. It's going to present individuals, institutes, projects, consortiums, sites, and so on. Everything is going to be modeled as a party, and we will see how it's going to be, how all these different concepts are going to be accommodated in a single term. So first of all, is that there is many-to-many relationship between data sets and parties, so that, for example, actually this association is not exactly defined. So it's maybe an ownership, maybe it's a contribution, and so on. We will discuss it later to see how data sets and party are linked together. But for now, just see that parties have a role in data sets and vice versa. Parties can be located in different ways, like by URL, by DOIs, by phone numbers, by geographical location if they are stationary, and by emails, for example, if they are persons or offices and so on. So this locator actually is a representative for multiple subclasses of this kind of contact mechanism. And then parties can have statuses. Like, for example, a party or a person can be approved to do something, can be approved to be a member of something, can be rejected, and so on. This kind of information are all captured in the status. But to prevent the status from being like a free text, we have a status types associated to a status, so that, for example, if the short or controlled list of statuses that each party can take an at any specific time. The latest status here is the current status, but the history of the statuses and their time is also kept in the history. So that, for example, if you want to know what was the status of this specific party at a specific time, it should be somehow recoverable from this link that is called history. But again, there is a problem that, for example, different parties, like a person, can have different statuses than an organization. For example, an organization can be established, or a project, for example, can be started, can be running, and then can be closed, but a person cannot be started. So the status types should be meaningful to the party. And for this purpose, we have another class here that is called party type. With this party type, we control which status types are valid for that specific party type, and then the parties can choose one of those statuses that is valid for their type. But when we have this party type here, then maybe there is no need to have person and organization as subtypes, because the party type can capture and also can cover these two types and more. So it can be something like this, that instead of having subtype, we have party type, so that each party knows its type. And then when the party type is known, the valid status of that type are also known. And then the status is like a valid item in a controlled list for that specific party. But when we remove this organization and person, something else happens, which is like the attributes belonging to a person normally are different than attributes belonging to or required to have an organization. Like for an organization, maybe we have registration date or VAT, tax identification number, and so on. But for a person, maybe we need a birth date or something else. So when we remove these things from here, there should be another way to also define custom attributes for each party type. And for that purpose, we have some sort of like a profile here that each party type can have custom attributes that a specific party can take them later and provide value for them. So that, for example, if this party is an individual has a birth date, then this party should have a birth date data also here. So the set of custom attributes belonging to a party type can be considered as a profile for that party type, and data entry form, for example, can take this into account to have not only the shared party data attributes, but also a specific custom attributes for that party type are also rendered to the UI, and data entry is managed through the UI, for example, to capture this information. And then when we have parties, normally we need to know about the relationship between the parties. Like, for example, if someone is hired by a project or by an institute, or if a project is run by an institute or by a university. So this party relationship here is capturing the relationship between the first party and second party, so that we know first party has a relationship to the second party. And this party relationship here can be temporal, for example, so that we can say the first party is in relationship employment with the second party from 2010 to 2014, for example, or unbounded or whatever. So there are some information also related to the relationship that somehow are used to manage the association between the parties. As usual, with the party type and the status type, we also control the relationship type so that not all the relationships in the world are here, so we can define a list of relationships that are valid in our system, so that if two parties are going to have a relationship, that relationship should be one of these valid types here. And this is also captured as a conceptual concept or conceptual entity, let's say, so that at the system design time, we can also put it as a data into the system, so that the system administrators or we as a developers can define a set of relationship types. But this set of relationship types can differ from installation of BEXIS to installation based on the requirements. And now, something that happens is that when I have relationship between a party to another party that is controlled by this type, maybe I want to know which type of relationships are valid between any two single party types. Like, for example, is there possible to have an employment relationship between a project and a university? It doesn't sound good or meaningful. But employment normally happens between a person and an organization or a project and so on. So to also restrict which type of relationships are valid between any two parties, we have this kind of party pair that is just pairing a source and a target party. Like, for example, source can be a university, target can be a person, and then this pair is linked to employment. Then we know that university can employ a person. And then when here I'm going to associate a person to a university, the system can force me to choose only employment because there is no other way. So this kind of track here can be traversed in different ways, like by suggestion from this way or by controlling and validation from this way. The system can help the user to navigate through proper relationships, proper relationship types, and so on and so on. We will also see an example like this here. So from here that we have parties and party relationships is that they are all temporal, like parties have lifetime, and also relationships have lifetimes. And then with this, when we are going to make a relationship between two parties, that relationship cannot exceed any party's lifetime. So for example, if a project has an end date of 2017, and then organization has a lifetime of 2019, the relationship between them cannot exceed 2017 because one of them is not valid at that time. So this kind of restrictions are also applied based on the information that is gathered by the system. So just an example of this part, party type and party pairing. Look at this example here. Let's say that institute is a party type and project also is a party type, and run or running is a relationship that I want to establish between an institute and a project, so that I can read institute can run a project. With this, is that I can create a pair between an institute project party type and a project party type, and then link them to here, so that it's read institute runs a project. I can do it, for example, here, a project can have a child project, so it can be self-association. And also here I can say an institute can employ a person, an institute can have a child institute, and also a project can employ a person. So with this kind of pairing, I can define the rules that who can have what kind of relationship to whom else. And then going to the second part, it was about the types. Now we are going to create some parties, for example, to see how they are related to each other. This is the previous slide. And then I create FSU, like Friedrich-Schiller-University, as an institute. I create BEXIS as a project, and then say FSU has a relationship to BEXIS that is called run, which means FSU is running BEXIS, and then the restriction is that from 2011 to 2016. Also, I can say, for example, Jawad is a person that is hired by BEXIS. BEXIS employs Jawad from 2011 to 2016. So this kind of relationship can create almost any combination. And the good thing is that this part can be managed by system administrator. So if they have new type of relationship types, they can just create it. And if they don't like this one, they can omit it. But at the system design time or system development time, let's say, we will ship the system with some basic configuration so that it's easy to use it and not make everything harding or confusing. Okay, I don't stop here or?
Just a short question to this relationships, then yeah. There's also the direction of the relationship.
Yeah,
inside.
Actually, if you see these colors here, they mean the source.
Okay. So that's inside the conceptual.
Exactly, yeah.
Should
be handled,
yeah.
It's there, yeah.
Okay. Good.
So FSU is the source of this.
Yeah.
So it means FSU runs BEXIS or FSU employs Jawad and so on.
Yeah. Okay.
And also here, the relationship also have source and the other one, target or destination.
A target. Okay.
Question?
Okay.
Okay. So, and the second part of the administration package is the data plan package. This one, data plan actually is designed to enforce the policies and also to determine which data set can have access to which data structure and so on. So, for example, if you are a party like FSU, FSU can have multiple data plans, and as a person associated to FSU, if you are going to submit a data set, you have to choose one of these data plans, and then data plan, when chosen, is associated to your data set, and then with that data plan, you are basically agreeing on some policies, like for example publishing policy or access policy or ownership policy. So for example, FSU can demand for ownership transfer. So if you are going to submit a data set under FSU administration, then you are also delegating your copyright to the FSU, for example. So this kind of policies are captured by the data plan. Actually, there are more here, but it's just a small part of the data plan and what's its purpose. So this party is the general party, so it's also possible that the project has a data plan or a single person also has a data plan and so on. So how the system is providing these facilities is up to the system behaviors, but conceptually it's possible for any single individual or a project or a consortium of the projects and so on to have a set of data plans. Okay, then no question here?
No.
Okay, let's quickly move on to the semantic package. We have designed this semantic package to actually annotate the variables, attributes, metadata and data in order to enhance data discovery and also data integration. So the semantic package is going to help us with a higher level of attribution, let's say, so that we can either automatically or with the help of experts or domain experts to find out which part of data sets are equal or similar to which other parts, so that, for example, in the search system, we can use it, or in the data integration and visualization and analysis later, we can also use this kind of semantic annotation or semantic inferences. So as usual, we have the core concept. We call it ontology, that is again hierarchical, so it's possible to have sub of these ontologies. And the ontology is defined to be a set of relationships between a group of terms, which something like this. We are using this pattern of subject, predicate, object, and all the subject, predicate, objects actually are a relationship between the term concept. So it's possible to define almost anything as a term. Like, for example, you can define a subject even as a term, another predicate as another term, and so on. So it's possible to create complex patterns of subject, predicate, objects, in that, for example, object is another relationship, or the predicate itself is another relationship somewhere else, and so on. And then this relationship between the terms create a term relationship, which we put it into an ontology, and then hopefully we can process these relationships to conclude about something, and then using that conclusion we can say, okay, this variable is equal to this variable, or this data item is similar to this data item, and so on. It's again not about how it's implemented, but it's the concept that we are going to have, and then when we have this concept, we can attach it to different semantic description, like we have semantic description to the data container. So that, for example, here, data container can be semantically described as a unit or as an entity or as a characteristic, although not limited to these three items. But in our case, it seems to be enough for a data container to play one of these roles. But again, as I said, is open for discussion at the implementation time. To put them all together here is that we have hierarchical ontologies that actually are a composition of the terms and subject, predicate, objects, and that all the rest is just linking this concept of term to the rest of the conceptual model. And again, it's just the conceptual model implementation may differ in terms of what can be implemented and also how it's implemented. Maybe, for example, in terms of RDFs or OWLs or whatever else, it's actually not started. So nothing more to say here. And then, may I bypass the security? It's, I guess, 10, 12 slides. It's important, so let's go through it like faster. Okay, with the security package, we have three main responsibilities: authentication, authorization, and auditing. With authentication, we will like to have internal user base for authentication, as well as single sign-on that is relying on external authentication providers. With authorization, we would like to control the access to the functionalities of the system and also control access to the data objects, like controlling access to a data set, and also to have like more complex authorization rules, so that, for example, you can say write access is granted to those who are accessing a data set that has attribute A in its metadata and attribute B in its metadata, and so on. Like, for example, if there is a variable named temperature in this data set, no one can access that, and so on. And with auditing, we would like to log any activity on the data objects of interest to know who has done what and when and on what, and so on. I won't talk about this part and directly go to authorization to see how it works. Our authorization system is permission-based, so that we have a triple of subject, permission, object, so that subject can have a grant on an object, and that grant is actually the permission. When there is no permission means there is no grant, which is interpreted as deny, but also at the system level, we can switch this policy so that, for example, if there is no permission at all, we can grant everything. So there is a high level policy, but also there is some sort of default configuration. all the permissions again have time interval, so that you can say this subject is granted to delete any data set but just today, or something like this. So here we saw that there is a subject and an object. The next slide will talk a little bit more about what can be a subject and what can be an object, and also a little more about the permission. So a subject can be a user, can be a group, and can be a role. Groups and role are hierarchical, and also there is inter-associationship, like membership between users and group, groups belonging to roles, and also users belonging to roles. At the implementation layer, again, we have, I think, omitted the group to make it a little simpler. But in general, it's the concept that we are looking after. The thing is that when the authorization request is going to be processed, we know the logged-in user. And from the logged-in user, we have to compute, or actually to drive the effective subject. Which effective subject means that we have to process the user memberships from here and here, and any hierarchy here, to grab all the roles and groups that that user is member of, and then using the hierarchies process the effective list of subjects, and then that effective list of subjects goes to the next step to, for example, find the permissions that are associated with those effective subjects. And then the permission actually is a right, which the right can be attributed as read write, create write, execute write, or anything else write. So that, for example, you can have a read write on a data set, but not a delete write on a data set. You can have create data set write for always, but you can have read access, for example, until you are a member of a group, or until you are a member of a an institute, and so on. And the execute permission is actually reserved for the functions of the system that we will see here. Okay, with the objects, the main objects that we are going to protect against unauthorized access are the actions of the system. So that, for example, if there is a function in the system, we would like to protect that by the security, so that, for example, you cannot create a data set, or you cannot download another data set, and so on and so on. But in addition to that, we would like to create permissions that are controlling data objects. Like, for example, in general, you can read data sets, because reading is an action, but you cannot read data set number 12 for any reason. And that data set number 12 actually is a data object here that we are going to control access to it through the authorization system. And then a more complex one can be an expression, that this expression actually is a logical expression based on the attributes of the data objects, like data sets, metadata, and so on, that when evaluated, it will yield to a true or false. So if the expression is evaluated to true, means that you have access, or you are permitted to access that target. If not, then you are denied. So to put all of them together is that subject, permission, object. Subject are users, group, and roles with their hierarchy and associations. Objects are data and actions. And actions are, again, controlled, not any action, just those that we want to be controlled. And permission can act as on an expression, like complex authorization rule. And also the permission types are controlled, so that we know which operations are permitted on objects. That was it. No question here. I think there is a room for one question. If you are just smiling. Okay.
One maybe shortly. I don't know if it was there, but we then also need, or there's maybe also need of the security connected to this administration.
Yeah, there is actually this one is not here, no. It's connected, but it's not visible here.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. It's actually users and roles. Users are connected to the party.
Okay.
Roles are connected to the party relationship, I guess.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Select slide.
Okay, the last one is that we want the geo package to be outsourced because it's complex to implement it. But the conceptual model actually is our demand from any outsource geographical system to allow us to have features, their geometries and attributes over those features to be associated to any party that we want. So that, for example, we can geographically describe an institute, a project, a site or a plot, and so on. And with the feature, we would like to know its geometry, to visualize it, for example, on a layer map, or to have the feature attribute value so that, for example, we know some information about that general area from the geographical perspective. And then we want to use this information in combination with our metadata and also with the data to generate on the fly maps for the geographical visualization of the data set. Something that is a concern here, we want to have the security integration so that, for example, there is no way to bypass our security system to access anything in this outsourced geographical system. And also we want to have API accesses to querying this kind of information and also to visualizing them in the external system and use the visualized output in our interface. That's the whole thing that we want from a prospective geographical information system or server or whatever, or let's say facility. Okay, then if you are more interested, there are some articles written over this conceptual model, and also the whole conceptual model in UML format and also exported to HTML is online here, so you don't need any specific tool or licensing to have a look at it. And then the next talk would be the overall system structure and the database design. With this conceptual model, we would have a system structure, system architecture that accommodates all this conceptual model into some sort of component-based design. And also, we have created a database design from this conceptual model for the system to run on it. In the next talk, hopefully we can also talk about the database design, maybe some design design paradigms or design constraints, principles, and so on, and show how the system is designed and so on. And then, thanks a lot for not questioning too much.
Thank you.
That's it. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.